Hello everyone, and welcome to the Fast Track Your CI/CD Pipeline with JFrog Artifactory Pro. So before we start the webinar, I would like to mention is that all the phone lines are muted for the better audio quality. And feel free to use the question answer panel whenever you would like to pose a questions. And end of the webinar, we will take all those questions. And if we are not able to complete all the questions, we will definitely follow up through the email. So feel free to use the question answer panel to raise any questions you guys have it, and we can start the webinar. So this side, Naren, I am part of the JFrog solution engineering team, and as part of this solution engineering team, we have approximately 3,000 customers with JFrog, and solution engineering team continuously work with all those customers to make sure that they are successful in implementing the automation using the JFrog products. So that's basically charter for the JFrog solution engineering team. So quick agenda of today's webinar is that first we will talk about the overview of the JFrog Artifactory, and then looking into that how the JFrog Artifactory or the Universal Artifact Repository for the DevOps team. Then we will be looking at that how JFrog Artifactory serves as a system of record, and look into the metadata, importance of the metadata into the today's age of binaries. So like we see that a lot of binaries have been produced on a daily basis, hourly basis. So how metadata can provide a better management of those binaries. Then look into it, how the other integration with other tools and systems, how we can integrate between the different CI tools. So we will talk about, and we will use the Jenkins as part of the today's webinar. We will talk about that. And then at the end, we will see how the Artifactory serves as a trusted Docker registry and how you guys can use it in your organization, because we know that container technology is continuously evolving and adopting into the enterprise level. So before we go further down, I would like to start a quick poll to basically find out how we can, how you are familiar with the Artifactory. So let me start a quick poll. Okay, you guys should have the poll, and I will appreciate if you can take a quick poll. So basically, as I expected, that we have a mixed up all the folks as part of this webinar. So that's give me good information on how the distribution of the audience. Thank you. And let's go back to the slide deck. So JFrog Artifactory is the only universal artifact repository manager as of now in the market. And when we talk about the universal, it's looking into all the different technologies we have into any enterprise. So we know that each enterprise is not only one technology stack, and that are different technology stacks. So that's the reason we are talking about that. It's only the one universal artifact repository manager in the market. And it fully supports software packages created by any language or technologies. So either you can take Java, Python, Ruby, and in fact, we recently just announced today that in the 4.15 version of the Artifactory, we are providing the support of the C++ package manager. So Conan is embedded into the JFrog Artifactory. So you have the now Artifactory also support the C++ package manager too. The other cool feature, which is the enterprise-ready features, supporting the secure, clustered, and high availability Docker registry. Artifactory enterprise version do supports a high availability environment where you can horizontally scale the Artifactory into your environment if you have a large enterprise setup, and also if you have a globally distributed organization, then Artifactory does provide, enterprise version does provide the replication feature and all, which are not discussed in today's webinar, but definitely we have other webinars and which focus on to those particular aspect of the Artifactory enterprise version. The Artifactory integrate with all major CI/CD and DevOps tool, either you talk about Jenkins, TeamCity, and Bamboo. So anything you you're probably using it, we might have already have the integration setup provided for that particular CI/CD tool. So it's better to check it out onto the JFrog website to find out if we already have those integration basically it's the information provided on the JFrog website. So when we talk about the JFrog Artifactory as a universal repository, so in the universal repository, you can see that so we do take care of the dev side of the house and also at the same time, the ops side of the house too. And when you talk about dev, so you have a different development technologies, like you can do the NPM, you can do the Debian, and you can Maven, so all in fact Yum, so all the different technology which are used by the dev team, so they basically use the same JFrog Artifactory to complete their development lifecycle. And at the same time, operation team, they are also using the tools like Jenkins and Hudson on the different CI/CD tools and TeamCity, which you can, the ops team can use it to basically manage their deployment into the production environment, stage environment and all. So this Artifactory is a common tool provided a seamless integration between the dev and ops. So that's the reason that it's universal repository which can take care of the both the teams and have, so that there is no basically the dropout or communication gap or anything which misleading between the these two teams. So that's where the Artifactory plays a bigger role into that whole environment. So now let's go back and take a look of Artifactory and what we will talk about in this demo, the different repository types. And also I will do a quick overview of how you can set up the PyPI development environment. So let me launch my browser. Okay. So this is the Artifactory where it's available into my local environment, which I set it up. And you can see all the different packages. It supports it into that whole environment. And currently, if you see that there's another JFrog product is the X-Ray, which provide the dependency analysis and the vulnerability analysis into your environment, which is not different, available default, and it's only available for the JFrog Enterprise version. But otherwise, if you look into the different packages management, so you can see all the different packages management available into this version. And as I mentioned, 4.15 released today, so I did not upgrade it yet, but you will see the C++ as well as part of that package management available. There are different features, and some of the very cool features are related to the one I already talked about it, repository replication. The second one is AQL, which is like kind of Artifactory query language. It's very similar to SQL. So basically JFrog also provided that Artifactory language, query language, which is pretty fast to basically perform any searches using the AQL language, using the command line. So you can use that too, and we will show you a couple of examples on how you can use it to the AQL. So there are other features, and there are some ecosystem availabilities, which we talked about, Jenkins and the different integration. JFrog also provides the JFrog CLI. Today we launched a 1.6 version of the JFrog CLI too. So you can also take a look of the JFrog CLI onto the wiki. These are the features available into the environment, into the JFrog Artifactory, which you can use it. And some of them, we already talked about it. And the other feature, I would say that whenever you need any help, you can simply go to the wiki.jfrog.com, and which provides all the information, including the Artifactory REST API, all the documentation which you are looking for it, it's available into the wiki.jfrog.com. So now let's go back and let me log in. So there are three different type. In fact, there are four different type of repositories you can create it into the Artifactory. There are local, remote, virtual, and distribution. So let's take it out the distribution. Distribution is more when you have a integration with the JFrog bin tray, which is another product for distribution your binaries or artifacts across globally to the different organization, internal or the external. So you will use the bin tray, and Artifactory does provide a seamless integration with bin tray using the JFrog distribution repository. So that's the one is used specifically for the distribution. And then we talk about the local, remote, and virtual. And just very high level, local is which is something local where you are building your own packages and you want to publish your packages into the Artifactory, you will be mostly using the local. Then we talked about the remote. If you are looking into some of the remote repositories over the internet, so you basically can configure the remote repositories which pointing to the any repository over the internet. For example, if you are using the Maven, then you will be pointing to the jcenter.bintray.com. So that's where the remote repository will come into the picture. And if your environment or the organization has a lot of different teams and a lot of different remote repositories, and you would like to encapsulate into one repository, so you will use the virtual. So virtual provides the flexibility so that you can have all your local and remote configured into one virtual, and so that everyone is using the virtual. So that if behind the scene, if you need to change anything on the local or remote, no dev team or the build team is impacted. So let's go to and create a local repositories. So for this example, I will simply just use the Maven to create it. And I will say Maven local pro. And for to create a local repository, that's all you need to do it. And we already talked about that X-ray is not available. That's the reason we don't have it configured. But if you look quickly, that there are some other some of the settings which you can do it for your environment, whether you want to handle the releases or the snapshot. There are some advanced configuration which you can do it. And also the replication, if you would like to set it up, which will be the push replication using the event-based or the cron-based, you can do it. So in order to create the local, we have to do that set. So if I create, then Maven local repo is already created. So now similarly, what we will do, we will go to the remote. So let me go to the Maven remote. So I will use the Maven again. So we'll do Maven remote pro. And you can see that whenever we already know what should be the URL over the internet, that's already defaulted, but you are feel free to change anything which you would like to change it in this. But if you don't, then that's all you need to do it basically to configure a remote repository. So if you create remote, so that's all we have to do it for the remote repository, then we go to the virtual. So let me create a virtual repo. So I will pick the same Maven package type for the virtual. So I gave the name, and that's all we need to do it. And then we need to basically select what all local and remote repository we want to add it into as part of this virtual. So let's add whatever we have already created. So we created Maven local pro. So let's add that, and then add Maven remote. So once you do that, you can see this is the order it will basically go and identify the artifacts whenever you are using it. So it will always go to the local repository first and then remote repository. And if you want to have a default repository where all the push or all the publish artifacts where they need to go it, so they will go to this Maven local repo. So if you click on this, this is how it's all done. So that's all you need to do it to configure the complete environment for the local, remote, and pro, the virtual. And similarly, what I did, I already created my PyPy local. So let me quickly go there and show you guys so you can see. So I have a PyPy local, and similarly, I have a PyPy remote. Oops, let me do that. So I have PyPy remote, which is pointing to the pypy.python.org, and then I have a PyPy virtual. Which is going to the PyPy virtual, which include the PyPy local and PyPy remote. So that's how you configure the PyPy too. And once you have all that done, you go into the search, go into the PyPy virtual. And whenever you go into it, PyPy virtual, you see set me up button. So in fact, most of the repositories, whenever you are looking how to configure the and set me up button is very helpful. So that's how you get all that information into the configuration, which you need to take care to configure your PyPy environment. And if you enter your credential, so it will take care and build that configuration using the credentials. So that's how you need to do it. And for example, it gives you the complete instruction how to do it. And I can show you that this is the information already basically set it up in my environment. So let me go back. So let me go back and show you guys my PyPy RC file. So this is how I basically configured my local host 8094 port. And this is the encrypted password, which was as soon as we enter the credential, that's how it used that all that. And then this is the one of the configuration, and the other configuration which we talked about, which we saw it, that you need to also configure to resolve the packages. You need to configure the pip and the pipconf file. So basically, you created a directory pip, and then under that pipconf. So let me go and quickly show you guys that configuration too. So if you do this, this is the configuration for the pipconf, which you can see it. And once you have all that configuration, you go back to the repository and you see that we have PyPy remote, and you see the PyPy remote cache, which don't have anything. And once we will start, we will install that package. So let me install a simple package, and you can install anything using the pip install command. So let me go and install the pip install APA. I'm just picking any package. So what it will go, it will do, it will go to the remote and configure and install that package with its all the YAML file. So once you, and if you refresh it, you will see that this package has already came and installed it. And you can see that if you next time, if you start using the same package, it will be cached locally into the Artifactory, and it will not go over the internet and download the same package again and again. So these are the quick steps where you can configure your PyPy environment. Now coming back to the slide deck, yeah. So we already saw the repository creation. We already saw the how we can configure the PyPy. So now moving on. So the other aspect of the Artifactory is to find out how the Artifactory plays a role of the universal artifact management and the distribution. So in this one, we are displaying the complete JFrog platform, and you can see that dev team is basically creating the new packages, new functionality, and declaring a lot of new dependencies. And in order to define or resolve those dependencies, all will be going into the Artifactory, which is connected to the JFrog, basically JFrog Artifactory connected to the dev environment, resolving all those dependencies. So once developer commit the change, it will go back to the source control. So source control, So basically source control has that new changes, whatever that the developer has committed it. And then what will happen that, well, whatever the CI server you have committed, that CI server basically take the new commit and start performing using the build tools to the build. And it's quite possible that all our dependencies are already resolved. But if there are any new dependencies, it will again use the JFrog Artifactory to resolve those dependencies and deploy the module artifact into the build info bomb. So build info, all the information is basically configured, collected, and push it back to the Artifactory as part of the build info bomb. So that's the CI server. We talked about it. And then other cool thing is that JFrog platform is that we talked about JFrog X-ray. So what's happening is that whatever the new dependencies you are downloading or the new artifact you are uploading, you can perform the any vulnerability analysis or dependency analysis or any impact analysis using the JFrog X-ray. So while that everything is continuously moving, JFrog X-ray is also analyzing all the things which are uploading into the Artifactory environment. Then after that, once your build is done, so what you probably will be having some kind of a automation QA. And what you can do based on the automation of the QA, you can upload the basically contribute the metadata and enrich whatever the artifacts already uploaded to be the more properties. So you can do that, and that's where that complete automation, how you want to move it from build promotion and everything comes into the picture. So we already talked about CI servers, and these are the critical points into the JFrog Artifactory, JFrog platform. And then let me completely build this diagram so that we can see. After that, what will happen is that all the build artifact is already in the Artifactory, and you have the your enterprise will have a different provisioning tool where you use it to deploy those artifacts or those builds into the production server. And a lot of people use the different tools like Chef, Puppet, Ansible, and all that. So some of the Chef and Puppet support will be also coming into the Artifactory soon, but you can use JFrog REST API or CLI to basically deploy it into the your production environment. And on the parallel, if your artifact needs to be distributed globally, you can use the distribution repository, which we talked about earlier, and use the bin tray so that all the other globally consumer or IoT devices can consume directly from the bin tray, which is behind the CDN network to support all your enterprise distribution need. So this is the complete JFrog platform. We already talked about three products, and then there is a mission control, which is comes free with the enterprise version of the Artifactory. And mission control to manage the multiple Artifactory instances. So you have a one tool to manage and look into the Artifactory globally distributed or locally installed Artifactory. You can use the mission control. So that's where the JFrog Artifactory is a kind of a universal platform, and to manage the complete, to be building the artifact management and also the distribution. So now moving on. So now let's take a look onto the some of the CI tools, which we will talk about the Jenkins and how the Jenkins can be configured, how you can perform the build, and then how you can basically promote the build into the your different repositories, and how you can use the REST API. So let's talk about and look at the quick demo on that. So let me go back to the Artifactory. And let me go to the Jenkins. So this is the Jenkins, and where you can basically go to Jenkins website and download the Artifactory Jenkins plugin. And we in this environment, I already have it. But whenever you need it, you can go to the manage Jenkins, and you can go to the manage plugins, and you can go to the install, which you can see the Artifactory plugin is already there. And I am using the 2.6. I should upgrade my environment, but you can basically go and upgrade that latest version too. So that's basically Jenkins Artifactory plugin configuration, and you can also add the Jenkins basically Artifactory environment into the Jenkins. And I already set up a project for the Maven Pro webinar. So let's take a quick look onto this configuration of this project. So this is the project name, and I'm using the GitHub project examples, and the same examples is also available into the JFrog GitHub training GitHub location too. So if you want to use it. So here you will provide that GitHub configuration, and then you talk about the release configuration where you give the different release branch. And then in this section, you will talk about how to resolve the artifacts from Artifactory. So in this one, you can give that Artifactory basically URL and the repository where it needs to basically, whenever the build is happening, then how it can resolve all the dependencies using this Artifactory configuration. And this one is, this talks about all the pre-steps, what kind of build we want to do it, where the pom.xml and the goals, basically which commands we would like to execute for this particular project. And then we talked about basically where we need to deploy that artifact. So let me pick my, yeah. So I will be using Artifactory, which we saw it, and then I'm using the Maven stage local and Maven snapshot. So all the snapshot will go into the Maven snapshot, and all the basically stage will go, all the release candidate will go to the stage local. And also at the same time, if you want to add more properties, you can add more properties. So I'm just adding the Pro Webinar CI/CD as a property. So whenever any artifact will be uploaded, it will be uploaded using this and have these properties. Some of the include and exclude pattern, we definitely don't want any password or secret information. So I'm just putting that exclude pattern into this one. So that's a simple configuration where you can configure the project. Let me save this one. And let me go and quickly build this particular project so that we can see it. Let's just wanted to see the console output. So this build is successful, and you can see it's a 3.29 build. So let's go back to the Artifactory. So if you go to the Maven snapshot local, and multi-three, so you see that this particular war file created today. So that was the build we did it, and you can, let me go back to the properties, and you can see that properties are added. So if you go into the Artifactory, so this was the general page of all that information, like what the size, what is the repository path, and when that's created, and if there are any activity on the download and the remote download. So you can see everything into this particular general page. Anything related to the dependency declaration will be here too, and Artifactory calculates the SHA-1 and MD5, and you can definitely create the, you can also have the SHA-256. There is a property by which you can set it up the SHA-256 too. And the next tab will talks about any permission related to these this particular repositories, which comes directly to this particular artifacts. Properties, you can add the different, add custom properties to, or you can use the REST API to add the custom property. You can also have the property set. If you want to add the property set, you can do that. And if you want to apply the same property recursively to that folder, you can simply click on this checkbox, which can take care of everything. If you are interested in to any activity on this particular repository, on this folder or any at that level, you can simply add the watcher. And there, I think there is a governance, which we don't have in this scenario. The other thing is that we saw that build was done, and then it was a Jenkins build. So Artifactory and Jenkins is basically they have a both way link. So you can go from here to the Jenkins page or from the Jenkins, if you want to come to the Artifactory, you can come back to Artifactory True. And if you go to the build, which will take you to the build browser for the of the Artifactory, where you can see all that build information related to this project and what kind of agent we have used it, how much time it took it, and the link to the Jenkins. And it also give you all the build snapshot, basically published modules. So you can see in this particular module, how many artifacts, how many number of dependencies. And if you want to go down and further look into it, you can go and take a look as well. And the next steps talks about the environment. So if you want to find all that environment, which basically which we are sending it from the CI tools, which is done using the Artifactory plugin. So the, all the environment information is also part of the build. And if you want to search anything, for example, you want to find out what Java version it used it, you can simply go and search it and it can give you the complete information related to the Java. So that's, you can use it. And if any issues identified using the during the build, that information will also be here. If you have configured what all the different kind of licenses allowed as part of your organization, you can configure into the admin section in the licenses, and it will enforce those licenses which you would like to basically identify, found out into the build. We don't have any integration of the governance because now I think moving forward we will be having more X-ray to do this job. So that's the reason. The other cool feature of the build browser is the diff. So if you have two different build and you need to find out if your previous build was successful and the current build is failed, or either way, you want to find out what is the difference into these two builds, and you know that nothing has changed at the code level. You want to know if anything in the environment level, a variable or something has changed, and you want to find out the differences between these two builds, you can simply do the diff. And diff can tell you what are the updated, what are the unchanged, which is a very good feature of the different build differences which you can find out. Release history, as of now, this particular build don't have any release history, but you can certainly, when you are promoting it, you can see the different release history into in this environment. And the last one is the complete build info JSON, which I was talking about, which comes from the CI tools. And if you want to parse that tool using the some third-party tool, or you want to integrate using the put this build info JSON for the different integration, find out dependencies and everything, you can use it, this build info JSON too. So let's go back to Jenkins. So the last build was this one, and let's move this to staging. So let me go to the build release, Artifactory release staging, and let's say ready to move to stage on today's date. And I will simply click on this, and then let's see if we can see the console output. So what it will be doing, it will be taking this build from the Maven snapshot and moving to the Maven stage. So I think it's successful. Let's go back. So let's go back and see the Maven stage local and go back to the multi-3, and you see that 3.29, which just came into the Maven stage local. And now if I go back to the build, which is the 39, so last build was 39, and if you go to the release history, that's how you can see that that particular build was basically moved to the Maven stage local. And similarly, you can promote this to the production, which is the Maven release local. So you can do all that. So now let's go back and go back to the artifacts, and what we will do, we will just take one particular and see how the REST API can play a bigger role into this one. So let's pick the latest one, which whatever we just uploaded it. And let's go back to the terminal. So let's do a simple head request on this particular artifact. So if I do that, it will simply get it that particular artifact, which is a no-brainer because that's what we did it. But there is another cool feature of the release keyword. So if you simply remove the version from this particular version and just add the keyword release, and similarly remove it from here, so what it does, it gives you the basically the largest or latest artifact belonging to this particular criteria. So here we are looking multi-three and the var files, and we know that it's only the 3.29 is the latest one which we just uploaded it. So that's how you can see it. But you can also look into the different properties. For example, if I want to find out what is the artifact which is the QA approved, so I need to simply add QA approved is equal to yes into my criteria. And if I do that, I get the 3.25. So if I go back to the browser and see whether 3.25 is the latest one and has that property added. So if you can see it, so this is QA approved yes. So no other artifact into this particular Maven stage local has that property. So that's how you can identify and search the different artifact based on the different properties. And this was just one example. What if you need more information on how you can use it? The REST API, as I mentioned earlier, simply go to the wiki.jfrog.com and you can see all the different REST API which you can use it using the command line. So let's go back to the slide. Okay. So we definitely cover these are the Maven build. We cover the promotion, and let me also do the release promotion of that particular artifact. So let's go back to the Jenkins. Oops. So let's go back to that project and the 39. So if you see that there is a little icon that artifact release promotion. So if you click on that, and then you need to define where you want to move this particular artifact. So in this case, we will moving to the Maven release local. And source will be the Maven stage snapshot stage. So okay, I will use the Maven stage local. That's where we will use it, and we will use the simple copy function. So what it will do behind the scene, basically, it's Artifactory is the checksum based storage. So behind the scene, it's not basically duplicating your storage, but simply doing a DB operation of updating the DB with the moving to the pointer to the Maven release local. So I will do promote the build. And it's a simple copy operation, and that's the reason it's very quick. And once you do it and you go into the Maven release local, which is on the top, and you can see the 3.29, which we just promoted to the, and it's the same promotion. You can also use the APIs. So there's no reason you need to do it from the UI. And once we go to the release history, you can see the complete history of that release. So initially it was came to the stage and then we released it. So that's a complete promotion cycle of the build, which we just performed using the Jenkins. So now let's go back to the slide. Yeah. So we already saw the Jenkins build info API artifact metadata. We covered most of the point on here. Now moving into the age of binaries, right? So if you compare the 10 year back or 10 plus more year back, the different methodologies was used. And at the time, for example, agile methodology where the release was not that frequent, or the builds and build promotion to the production environment was not that frequent. Probably most of the enterprise were doing on a quarterly, monthly basis kind of a promotion. And you can see that slowly and gradually how that explosion of the binaries coming into the picture. Then CI/CD pipeline, CI/CD came into the era, and then DevOps. And now we are talking about the microservices. So all that application which was having the one build kind of thing, now everything has been broken into the microservices. So you can see that each application now has multiple binaries to manage it. So, and now we talked about the containers. We have the Docker, which you can do multiple, basically, binaries which you are building it on a regular basis. And a lot of enterprise basically performing that production deployment on a daily basis and multiple time in a day. So that's the era we are talking about, the age of binaries. So if you don't have any metadata in this age of binaries, it's kind of a finding the needle in the haystack. So you don't know what is deployed where. You don't know how to trace the binaries. You don't know which one I need to move it to the production. So that's the reason the managing your binaries are very key in this particular era. So that's where you need to enrich the binaries with the metadata so that you can find out, you can search it, you can promote the right one. So adding metadata, then finding the metadata. So Artifactory does provide a lot of functionality by itself. For example, automatically this has that all the metadata added, and we already saw that you can add the more custom metadata. And some of the metadata is already implicit, which we saw the size, download, stats, you can see it. And then how to find out how to use that metadata. That's where the Artifactory query language comes into the picture, where you can use the AQL, and we can see some of the example. So AQL is designed mostly for the simple way to formulate your complex query, and it does not go through any wrapper. It directly basically convert that into the SQL behind the scene. It's much more fast and reliable. And you can define the different search criteria, build it and execute it. And it runs on the local remote caches and the virtual repositories. And then it's basically results are coming back into the JSON format. You can use it, and it's one AQL language. You can use it across different artifacts, repositories. And there are some basically flow on how you can use the AQL language. So basically you have item, which is the artifacts, and then you have a build and the promotion, that these are the different basically item which you can use it into the AQL. And then look into the different properties. You can find the, you can configure your AQL language, which you can use it. There are some of the examples. For example, in this one, find what artifact has been deployed to staging. So you simply give the repo equal to Maven release local, which matches with the multi-3.var, starter var. And then these are the properties kind of a link to that, and these are the outputs you are looking as part of the AQL language. So it will include the path, created date, and the download stats as part of the output. Similarly, if you are looking with the JFrog X-ray product, this is the different AQL. So these are some of the examples which you can use it for the AQL. Let me quickly go and show you one couple of simple examples of the AQL. So I have one is this particular gate staging AQL, and what it does, let me quickly get you the AQL. So what it's doing, it's looking the lib snapshot local, and anything matches multi3.var, it's fetching all that with the repo name, path created, stats download. So you can see all these outputs as part of this particular AQL command. And the other cool feature is that we are not using our clear text login or password. We are simply using the API key, which you each user can generate its own API key. And after the, whenever you want to regenerate another one, you can generate another one. So that's how you can do and add that into that your curl command and simply ask and execute that AQL language, AQL query from your terminal. So yeah, I have another one, which is the pro staging one. In this one, let me quickly get that one. So I'm looking the main stage local and looking the multi-three started var where the property QA prod equal to yes. And we know that we saw it earlier, it was only the 3.25. So that's where the output came in. So these are the different AQL example, which I quickly show it to you, but it's not limited to these. It's very extensive and you can basically perform anything using this AQL. And if you need more information, you can always go to the wiki.jfrog.com AQL and you will get it all that information there. So now moving to the last portion of this webinar, which is the Docker. And as you know, probably already heard it, that JFrog Artifactory provide the secured cluster HA Docker registry, and it says it's a local trusted registry which you are looking, and it's kind of enterprise ready Artifactory. So it does provide that HA capabilities and some of the other capabilities. And because you know that whenever you ship with the Docker, there are other things as well when you are running anything with the Docker. So if everything is all part of the Artifactory, where Artifactory provide the universal platform, so you can all have into one Artifactory repository management system. So I was talking about JFrog Artifactory already provide the HA. You can add more nodes into the environment to provide more HA capabilities. We do provide the security model. We have the default user group permission target, which you can configure it. It does provide the different integration with the enterprise system, whatever your organization is using it. We probably already have the integration with that. Work with all the modern, the latest DevOps platform and the tools. That's the goal of the JFrog. So we do continuously enhancing our environment to support anything new coming into the DevOps world. So you can configure a Docker client using the two different mechanism. You have to use the reverse proxy mechanism if you're looking the port method or the subdomain method. So these are the two out of the box configuration you can use it. We have seen it, different customer using the different method. A lot of people use the different port to the point into the different local Docker repositories or the remote repositories which you can configure it. So what I will do, let me quickly go back and show you the quick demo on the Docker. So, and let me, so I'm running this particular, this Artifactory as part of my Docker client, and this is the Docker this is the HA version of the Artifactory using the Docker. So what I will do, let me quickly show you guys. So what I will do, I will pull a Hello World, which is the famous example. I will just pull that particular application using the localhost 5000, which is pointing to the Docker remote. So when it will be pulling out, it will be going to the Docker remote and pulling that latest tag. And whenever, as soon as it will be done, we should be able to see the, let me go and remote cache. So you can see that whatever we just downloaded it, it's already downloaded into the Docker remote cache with the different layers. So you can see all the layers into the Artifactory. And then what I will do, I will re-tag that one to the, okay, let me quickly do the retag to the pro webinar, and I'm doing the port 5002 because my local is configured using the port 5002. And then what I will do, I will push this back into the 5002 to the Docker. And now if I go back and let me refresh. So you can see the same image now pushed back into the Docker dev local too. So that's how you can basically configure, and we do have all the documentation how you can run the JFrog Artifactory on the Docker environment. And now we are seeing a lot of customers is already doing it and using the Docker and taking the Docker into their production environment. So let's go quickly and recap that we already talked about the overview of the JFrog Artifactory. And we talked about how the Artifactory plays a universal artifact repository for the DevOps, how it can also do the behavior as a system of record. We looked into the metadata, importance of the metadata in the age of current binaries. We saw the Jenkins integration, but it's not limited to the Jenkins. There are other as well. And then Artifactory as a trusted Docker registry, which we saw it. So, and while we will take up the question and answer, we will have our last poll that we would like to collect some feedback that what topics would you like to cover in the future. So let me go back and launch the poll. Okay, let me close the poll. Thank you for your feedback. And we can take any questions. And these are the future webinars of JFrog. So feel free to go to the JFrog webinars and look at what is suitable for you. So we have a normal webinar series for the Tuesdays. And we have a partner and special topics, which we take it up on time to time. And you can see on the webinar whatever the upcoming webinars we have. And so we have one questions that folks want to know that how they can control the order of the local repositories into the virtual repositories. So you saw that I showed it to you different. Basically, if you go to the virtual repository, you see it that there are different. As soon as you go to the artifact repository resolution, you can see there are different resolution you can simply drag and drop. So you can pick and basically move that local repositories to different order which you would like to edit. So that's how you can manage it to the different basically the resolutions. The other questions is that whether we have the similarly how that build info is coming from the coming and populating into the JFrog Artifactory. I think I did mention about it that it's part of the Artifactory plugin. So we do provide, as part of the Jenkins plugin, that all the build info is already calculated and captured and pushed it to the Artifactory. But we also launched the JFrog CLI 1.6 today. And there are some of the feature available into that CLI where you can basically wrap it out that build info and push it to the Artifactory too. So I would suggest that go and take a look at the JFrog CLI, which you can use it and push the basically all the build info into the JFrog Artifactory too. So you can definitely take a look on that too. There is one question that can we do multi-push replication? Yeah, definitely. Artifactory Enterprise does provide that multi-push replication. So if you have a distribution across the geo where you want to, as soon as that any artifact is uploaded into one environment, you want to replicate into the multiple different geo locations, you can simply configure the multi-push replication. You can add multiple instances where you want to replicate the same artifact. And as Artifactory is the checksum based storage, if that particular artifact is already available into the other end, it will not recopy it and it will simply update the stats with the replication. So that's how the Artifactory replication is very efficient whenever you have a very large distribution enterprise organization and where you need to distribute artifacts across the global locations. Probably, I think that's all for today's webinar. Thanks for joining the webinar and see you the next time. Thank you.